والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصلي عليه الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رحمة للعالمين وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا خاتم النبيين مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا من فيض فضلك في بدء وفي ختم أزكى الصلاة بلا حد ولا أمد على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلاة تشفينا وسلم عليه سلاما يداوينا وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace, salutations, blessings and mercy upon the greatest creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dearest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Imam of the Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the leader of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our master, our liege lord, Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. On his companions and the Ahlul Bayt and the awliya of the Ummah of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, we are gathered again for another monthly Friends of Allah. The awliya Allah are gathering in the name of those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those whose names still revive our hearts, those whose names allow us to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this gathering an honored gathering for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this majlis such a majlis in which we gain His rida, His pleasure, in which we gain maghfirah from Him, pardoning from Him, forgiveness from Him, His afuv. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this gathering in the name of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a means for us to gain the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a means for us to better our physical and our spiritual state. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through mentioning the names of the awliya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal His mercy upon us and envelope us in His mercy and keep us in that mercy till we pass and beyond that. Alhamdulillah, so we gathered here again to talk about another wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was a great man. A great man who I would say his name will still echo in this world till the Day of Judgment. Rather, it will echo even on the Day of Judgment. It will echo even on the Day of Judgment. He was really, he had the qurba of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a man who was a zahid, an ascetic. He had the ma'rif of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was an arif. He was an alim. He was also an alim. He was a man, sometimes when he would speak in his time, the people of his time, the ulama of his time, did not know what he was talking about. They could not comprehend the knowledge he had and what he was talking about. And through our discourse today, you will see that he made such statements that it makes people wonder, ulama wonder, even arifin of his time, they will make them wonder that what knowledge was he on? Where was his knowledge coming from? An alim, a zahid, a man whose way, and in Kashful Mahjub of Huzur Data Sahib, Ali Al-Hajweri, rahimahullah ta'ala, we also did a Friends of Allah upon him. He mentions his way, and he mentions the way of this Sheikh, and he called it the Taifuriya way. The Taifuriya way, and this way was of Mahabba, of love. And you'll see some of his statements of how it was a way of love. They didn't go into this state of hal and ahwal and you have to do this and do that. No, his was a way of love. And the maqam he reached was beyond. That even like Junaid al-Baghdadi had to praise him. Even people like Ibn Arabi had to praise him. Imam Manawi, various other people, even Huzur Data Sahib himself had to praise this person. For the maqam he reached. And this person is none other than Taifur bin Isa bin Shurushan, commonly known as Abu Yazid al-Bustami, rahimahullahu ta'ala. The great Abu Yazid al-Bustami, some pronounce it as Bistami. This great wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a man of his time. But rather, throughout time, he was probably one of those rare gems that you would find. The awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they commonly, when there's a rare person or rare thing, they describe him as red sulfur. For it's hard to come by. And they described Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala as being the red sulfur. Such that he is hard to find. Really hard to find. Throughout time, you will not find a man like him. And what you should take heed by the title that al-Khawafi gave him. He called him Sultanul Arifin. Called him Sultanul Arifin, the leader, the king of the Arifin. Meaning, who's beyond him then? Sultanul Arifin, meaning in his time, he was the leader of the Arifin. After the Sahaba Ikram, he was the leader of the Arifin. After the Tabi'in, he was the leader of the Arifin. What a title to give Sultanul Arifin. The king of those who recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just a title alone should make you understand the maqam of this person. The rank of this person. How close he was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today we're not even going to dwell on his life really. We're just going to dwell on his maqam. And it'll be through his words. Of what statements he made, what he said. We're never going to go, I'm not even going to touch on a single bit of his life. We're just going to go through his statements on what he said so that we can understand how close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he was. He once made a statement. There was a time, a person in his time who said he was the ghost of the time. You know, he stated, he said, the governors and the kings are many, but the Amirul Mu'mineen is one. The Amirul Mu'mineen is one. And then he said that, there will be a king and then he will be killed, but the kings will be killed, but the Amirul Mu'mineen will stay. What he was trying to say is that I am the Amirul Mu'mineen. The awliya that are saying that they are the ghosts of the time, they will pass, but I will remain. Meaning in his time, that is. In his time, those people who are claiming to be the ghosts of the time, he was saying they will pass, but I will remain. And that's what happened. They passed, meaning they went, moved to the next realm, and he remained out of them. And he was trying to say that I am the ghost from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yeah, he made statements like that. But just this title of Sultanul Arifin. And then a person like Sayyiduna Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala to praise him. Sayyiduna Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala, we did a whole talk on him as well. And his maqam, You know, he's the one, the founder of the Masla of Wahdatul Wujud. Yes. And for decades and decades, ulama and arifin and awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are still talking about it. The split of Wahdatul Shuhud and Wahdatul Wujud. Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala said that he was named Aba Yazid. He was called Abu Yazid. But I call him, Ibn Arabi says, I call him Abu Yazid al-Akbar. Abu Yazid the Akbar. Ibn Arabi himself was called Shaykh al-Akbar. But he's saying what? Abu Yazid is al-Akbar. He is the greatest in creation. Meaning after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba Ikram, the Tabi'een, of the awliya, he is the greatest. His maqam you can attain, and I said before as well, his way was of love. Of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't take love in any other way. Yes. When we talk about intasawuf of love, we don't talk about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is just leaving yourself in love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Letting everything go and just loving Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once what happened was that somebody placed a lamp in his room. Somebody placed a lamp in his room and a candle or a siraj. And he said, "Inni ajidu wahshatan fi siraji." He said, "I get a bewilderment from this siraj, this lamp that's there." Meaning I get a different feeling from it. Something not very nice is a wahsha. You know, a wild animal, we call it wahshi animal. Okay? It is not used to people. He says, I'm uncomfortable around this lamp. I'm very uncomfortable around this lamp. And his student said, that, Ya Sayyidana, oh our leader, we borrowed this lamp from the grocers. And we said we will use it once. We said we borrowed it from the grocers and we said we will use it for only once. But we've used it twice. So what was it borrowed for? Only one usage. But what have they done? They've used it twice. And he said we used it twice. And then they said to him that, do you recognize the grocer? They said yes. He said to them, go and please him now. Go and please him. Meaning, go and ask him his permission that if we can use this lamp again. Look at the state. Just because he felt uncomfortable around the lamp, he then asked his murids or his students, what's the scenario behind this? And they said that it would be borrowed for grocer to use once, but we have used it twice. And because of that, it moved him into a state, instead of love, it moved him into a state of bewilderment. That's a lump. Look how small it is. We may have pens and watches that we borrowed, and then we've not given them back. But what? He took the state of that lamp, and it affected him. Just because it was borrowed. As soon as they pleased that grocer, meaning whatever he wanted, they gave him. As soon as they did that, the bewilderment, the wahshiya inside the state of Abu Yazid al-Bustami disappeared. It disappeared. Meaning that lamp was distracting him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that, what he was seeing with his eyes, what maqam he had, how close he was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for such a small thing to then move him away from that. Keep an eye on everything. Because every single thing can take a person closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to mention something in the starting which I forgot to do. And that was his grandfather. His grandfather was a Majusi in the start. His father, he's Abu Yazid, his father is Isa, and then his grandfather is Shiroshan. Shiroshan, his waqia is that there was a great sheikh called Ibrahim. And Ibrahim's son would commonly play with Isa. And Shiroshan said you will come and play with Isa. So what happened was Ibrahim said to his son that you cannot play with him. Why? Because he's Majusi. What happened was that he said to his son, or his son rather said to him, that what should I do? He said, call him, tell him to call me as a guest to his house. Tell Shiroshan, tell your friend to tell his father to call me as a guest to his house. Invite me to his house. So Shiroshan invited Sheikh Ibrahim to his house. Ibrahim came, and then Shiroshan said to Ibrahim that what is it that you want? He said that I want one thing. In that time, Shirshan bought some food. Ibrahim said, I'm not going to eat. Said, I'm not going to drink. Everything was there. Then he asked, what do you want? He said, I want you to accept Islam. He said, I want you to accept Islam. At this point, Shirshan is what? He's a fire worshipper. All this, Ibrahim said to him, I want you to accept Islam. And what happened there and then? Shirshan said what? Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. Imagine that. Just by saying it, he accepted Islam. The reason was that Ibrahim was a man of his time. He was a worthy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he had great character, and he was upright on the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Shirshan and his child, Isa, was such that they had also a great characteristic. Because when Ibrahim stopped his son from playing with the child, Isa that is, what happened? Ibrahim's child said to him, that father, they have great character. He's a man I can trust. I will not trust anybody else, but I will trust this child as my friend. I will trust his father also. Meaning they were already upon the characteristics of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So this is why Ibrahim saw that and he said, I want to meet him, I want to be his guest. And I will be his guest, and all he will take from me is to tell him to accept Islam, he will accept Islam. Iqbal said in Nigahe Wali mein ye taaseer dekhi, badalti hazaron ki taqdeer dekhi. That in the sight of a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have seen this wonder that they can change the taqdeer of any person. Of many, many people, they can change the taqdeer of. And this is what he did. All he needed to do was just prompt them to accept Islam, they accepted Islam. And look who came from them. Look who came from them. They accepted Islam, and then you add Sayyidina Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala come from them. Because they were on that character, that prophetic character of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala, his way was of tajreed. And tajreed doesn't mean here that he would seclude himself completely for the world. He would be in the world, but be drowned in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now he would be around people, but then not around people. You know, you have somebody in the room and you can talk. Happens in many gatherings, but that person is not in the gathering. Okay. He was like that. He would be sat with you, he would retain everything that you said, but he would not be with you, he would be with his Lord. He would be in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was his way of tajreed. And he would not leave anything for the next day. There was something that he did. He would not leave anything for the next day. Once what happened was that he said, himself he states, that فَقَدْتُ قَلْبِ. He said to his students around him, I lost my heart. I've lost my qalb, my heart. I've lost it. فَطْلُبُوا. فَطْلُبُوا الْبَيْتِ. Search in the house. He said what? I've lost my heart. Search for my heart in this house. What happened? فَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ. They found a bunch of grapes. مِئْلَاق. In a bunch of grapes. فَقَالَ. He said to them that you should return it to the grocers. What should you do? Return it to the grocers. And then give him charity as well. Return that grape, them bunch of grapes for the grocers, and give him sadaqah as well. Give him charity as well, or give him nafli sadaqah, just something on our behalf. As soon as his students took the grapes and they took it to the grocers and they handed it over and they gave the sadaqah, he said what? Wajadtu qalbi. I found my heart. Why? Because he was a man who would not leave anything for the next day. Would not leave anything for the next day. Many of the Sahaba ikram had this mazhab. I always tell you about, his name's gone out of my head, but many times I tell you those Sahabi that was with Sayyidina Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an. And whenever they would, because they came to Sham, he was the governor of Sham, and all the riches were opened up to the Sahaba ikram of Sham. And they would have different types of food on the table. They would, the bank account started. Yes, people will leave things for tomorrow now. They would save money, they would save dirhams. And he would outright say it's haram. A Sahabi of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would outright say it's haram. And Sayyiduna Amir Muawiyah, he wrote a letter to Sayyiduna Umar saying that you have to take him back to Hijaz. And Sayyiduna Umar called him back to Hijaz and said, look, your way is your way, you have to lead these people to do what they're doing. And then he wandered off. He wandered off into the wilderness as many of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. So Sayyiduna Abu Yazid al-Bustami was upon the same way. He would not leave anything for tomorrow. A bunch of dates was left in his house, which was meant to be finished the night before. But it remained till the next day. And because of that, he lost his heart. And he was telling people to find his heart. And they found a bunch of grapes. They found a bunch of grapes, which made him lose his heart. This was the way of Sayyidina Abu Yazid al-Bustami, rahimahullah ta'ala. Shaykh ibn Arabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, stated, أَنَّهُ كَانَ الْقُطْبَ الْغَوْسِ فِي زَمَانِهِ. He was the Qutb and the Ghaus of his time. He was the Qutb and the Ghaus of his time. And Sayyidina Ibn Arabi rahimahullah stated, min al-aqtabi man yakunu zahir al-hukmi. From the aqtaba, those who also have the zahir al-hukm, you know, the apparent leadership, they have that. And then, وَيَحُوزُ الْخِلَافَةَ الْبَاطِنَةَ مِنْ جَهَدِ الْمَقَامِ. And they also have the khilafat al-batiniya, the inner. So they have the outer khilafah and they have the inner khilafah. And those are the Khulafai Rashideen. The best examples. Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, he was the ghost of his time and he was the Khalifa of his time. Sayyidina Umar Farooq, he was the ghost of his time inner and he was the Khalifa of his time outer. Sayyidina Usman Ghani, the ghost of his time and he was the Khalifa of his time. Sayyidina Ali Karamallahu Jal Kareem was the ghost of his time and he was the Khalifa of his time. Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was also the ghost of his time, the first Mujaddid of Islam after the Sahaba Ikram. He was the first Mujaddid of Islam and he was the Khalifa of his time as well. Okay. So these are the best examples. But then he stated that you have those who do not have this apparent leadership. They don't have the apparent leadership. Then what? They have what? This inner leadership. This batiniya, the inner spiritual leadership. وَلَا حُكْمَ لَهُ فِي ظَاهِرِ. And they have nothing to do with the zahir. You know, in terms of leadership in the apparent, they have nothing to do with it. And what? Sayyidina Ibn Arabi gives example, Ka'abi Yazid. Abu Yazid Bustami was one of those men. He did not have apparent leadership, but in tasawuf, in the realm of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had that leadership. He was Sultanul Arifin. He had that leadership from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's something that you rarely find. In another place stated, Abu Yazid kana ala qalbi israfi. If you remember a long time ago, we was teaching the book of Imam Yusuf Nabhani, Jami Karamatil Awliya, in front of me here as well. We talked about the maqams of the awliya and the states of the awliya. In the starting of it, we talked about it. And in that we told you that many of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are upon the hearts of different anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam, upon the hearts of different angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we mean by that was that they were on their characteristics. And Sayyiduna Ibn Arabi, this is a knowledge in itself, is a vast knowledge in itself, that he states that Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala was on the heart, the characteristics of Sayyiduna Israfil. That's just a part of meaning. What Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala meant from him, and by stating that, is a different realm in itself, is a different science in itself. He states, for him was the Amr and his Naqis. For him is the Al-Amr. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Arruhu min Amri. The ruh is for my command. And Bayazid Bustami is stating that Bayazid had the amr as well, and he had the opposite of that. And whatever the opposite of the amr is, he combined between the two, and he states that this is a rank. This is Ibn Arabi stating this. This is a rank that only one person has throughout time. Only one person has throughout time. And that was the rank of Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala. وَلَمَّا تَقَلَّمَ فِي أُلُومِ الْحَقَائِكِ لَمْ يَفْحَمْ أَهْلُ أَسْرِهِ كَلَامُهُ. Like I stated before, when he would speak in regards to the sciences of haqqaiq, of truth, when he would come into them, it would be very, very hard for the ulama of his time to understand what he was talking about. Be very hard for them. If you read up on these, take Ibn Arabi, if you read these books, I can guarantee you, give it to an alim, he will read it once, twice, three times, four times, five times, and he still will not go through. Pick up Peer Mehr Shah Rahimahullah's books sometimes. They're in Urdu, for those of you that can read Urdu. It will take you once, twice, three times, four times, and he still might not go through what he's talking about. Such was their knowledge. Such was their knowledge. And these awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the sciences that you can talk about, which they commonly write upon, are the science of letters. Later on you'll see, he'll talk about the mountain of Saad. What's a mountain of Saad? You know the letter Saad? Somebody asked him that, have you seen the mountain of Qaf? Because the mountain of Qaf is nothing wondrous. The mountain of Saud is wondrous. What is he talking about? Do you understand that? Then he's talking about that the mountain of such and such letter and the mountain of such and such letter encompasses the whole world. What is he talking about? It's like a riddle. It's like a code, the Morse code, Da Vinci's code. What is it meant to be? How are you meant to work this out? Is a letter, Saud is a letter. What mountain does it carry? Ibn Arabi also talked. Ibn Arabi was profound for writing on letters and writing the secrets of letters. Who's done that? If you take the grandson of Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani, who are commonly mentioned, one of my favorite authors to read, Abdul Karim Al Jili, rahimahullah ta'ala. I'm commonly mentioned this, that he talks on just the dot of Ba. And then he proving Tawheed from it. He's proving all sorts from it. But then to just understand what he's trying to do, okay, it takes a lot. That book of his I had to read many, many a time, just to understand what he was talking about. Into the science of letters, into science of other things, in the science of alif, in the science of the dot, and so on and so forth. But this is something that we need to understand and take in if we really want to be men of haqqaiq, of truth. And the first stage of that is to start telling the truth. Take lies away from yourselves. Never lie in any situation. Remove lies from yourselves, then you become men of truth, or you come closer to the truth. So people wouldn't understand what he would talk about, what signs he would speak of. And this was the reason why many, many people of his time blamed him for many, many things. And it is stated, Ibn Hajar stated that roughly 7 times they blamed him and they tried to put fatwas upon him and say things about him. Once he did the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you can understand his maqam here. He did the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and blood started to flow from his eyes. Not tears, blood started to flow from his eyes. Once he prayed Jumu'ah, Fasami al-Khatiba yaqra'u, and he was in the Jumu'ah, he was listening to the khutbah. And the Khatib read, Yawma nahshurul muttaqina ila rahmani wafta. That the day we gather the muttaqin, the God-fearing, towards the Rahman. Meaning they'll be resurrected towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a group, wafta, as a group. And for fariha, he became happy. Really happy. Not fear, happiness. Fatara damu min aynayhi, he started crying out blood tears out of happiness. Hatta darab al mimbara, until he hit the mimbar. Until he hit the mimbar. He said, Qala ya ajaba. That, oh wonder. Kayfa yuhsharu ilayhi man huwa jalisuhu. How can the one be resurrected or gathered towards him, the one who sits with him? The one who is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then how can he be brought to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, Ana jaleesu man zakarani. I am with that person who mentions me. What do you mean metaphorically jaleez? That Allah literally means that I am sat with the one who mentions me. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who mentions him in a metaphorical way. Wal muttaqi zakiru lillahi ta'ala. And a muttaqi is always in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Falamma hushila al-Rahmani wa huwa maqamul amani. And then when he will be resurrected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is he with? He's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aman. What is indicating towards here is actually something in the ayat. What's that? Yawma nahshurul muttaqina illa ar-Rahman. The day we resurrect and we gather the God-fearing towards the Rahman, the merciful. He's trying to indicate that you do not need to be scared of this ayat in the Quran. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stating that the muttaqi will be resurrected and the hashr nashr will be done. They will be on the plains of Day of Judgment in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not have his wrath upon them. For he mentioned his sifat of Ar-Rahman. He's mentioned his sifat of Ar-Rahman. Do you get gathered and resurrected towards the Rahman just so that he can have azab upon you? No. He mentioned his sifat of Rahman to give you a signal that he will have mercy upon them. So this ayat is of what? Not of being sad, but this is an ayat of what? Being happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will be gathered in his court, in his presence, as in such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy will be upon you. And this is why he cried tears of blood, out of happiness. But other sign, he had no tears left. He had no water in his body to come from his eyes. He had left that behind. The only thing that he could come out of his body was blood tears. Yes, the tears of water were left behind. He had dried them out. The only thing that could come from him was blood tears. So this is what he stated, and all this waqia was just all in happiness that he will be resurrected amongst those people. For the one who loves the muttaqeen is part of the muttaqeen. Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala once stated, Qala ahadul mahjubin, one of the people who was veiled, meaning he was veiled in terms of reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said to Abu Yazid rahimahullah ta'ala, that sharibtu shurbatan, I drank a drink, metaphorical. When it comes to the Sufi, you have to take everything metaphorical. Yeah, the borrowed meanings, okay, isti'arat, borrowed meanings that you have to concentrate and understand what they're referring to. So it doesn't actually refer to an actual drink. It says sharibtu shurbatan, I drank a drink, falam azma ba'daha abada, I was never thirsty ever again. Who said it though? Ibn Arabi is indicated towards that. The one of those people who are veiled said this. Abu Yazid, I mean sometimes the believer his name, we say Bayazid. Bayazid Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala stated, Ar-rajulu man yashrabul bihara wa lisanu kharijun ala sadrihi min al-atshi. A man is that person who drinks oceans and the seven seas. The seven oceans and the seven seas, he drinks them all, but his tongue is still on his chest. You know, like a dog, when he's thirsty, what does it do? It has his tongue out. That's a sign that a dog is thirsty. So that's what he's trying to indicate to us, that a man is that person, meaning a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that person, what? That he can drink the seven oceans, but yet his tongue is still out of thirst. Seems weird, doesn't it? What he was indicating it towards was his own way, and that was the way of mahabba. Because when once you taste love, it's such a drink that you can never quench your thirst from it. You want more and more and more and more. When you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no end to that love. There's no end to that love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you drink in that love, the more you want of that drink. Does that come across to you? This was his way. Meaning this love never comes to an end. What the other person, and why Ibn Arabi said that person who asked the question, who made the statement, he was veiled. Why was he veiled? Because he was saying that the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or love towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has an end. That you have a limit where you can love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala too. And that once you quench that thirst has finished, that love has finished. But as he said, no, that love never finishes. That love carries on till the Day of Judgment, and it will carry on after the Day of Judgment. It will carry on in heaven, and whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has planned after that, it will carry on beyond that as well. The way of Bayazid Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala, the way of love, of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When people would see him, they would take barakah from him. They would rub him. They would rub him. They would rub his clothes just to take that barakah from him. And this was something he was known for. And what people started attacking him for this, and started saying things to him, that why do people do this? Why do people take barakah from you in this way? You know what he answered to them? He said what? He said, "Hum la yatabarrakuna bi." They don't take blessings from me. "Innama yatabarrakuna bi khul'ati rabbi allati khala'aha alayya." You know this khul'a that I have upon me, this clothes that I have upon me, they take barakah from this, and this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He granted it, so they're taking barakah from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted me. But meaning that they're taking barakah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I'm indicating towards here is, look at his knowledge. Look at his ma'rifah and his knowledge. Just by these answers, you can understand how high level knowledge he had from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see some of his statements. The alim is not that person who reads books and memorizes books. Yes? Why? Because if he forgets or his memory, there's a fault in his memory, then he's no longer an alim. But an alim is that person who attains knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everlasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pre-eternal, he's eternal, he's hayy, he's baqi, he's qadim, he's always been. When he's always been and he'll always remain, then that knowledge is not going nowhere. That knowledge will never disappear from you. So you see, these type of things he said will make you understand of how knowledgeable he was and what maqam he had. Once what happened was, he stated once, أَوْقَفَنِي اللَّهُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me stand in front of him. Just even him making that statement makes you understand that how close he was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what rank amongst the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he had. He said, أَوْقَفَنِي اللَّهُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me stand in front of him. وَقَالَ يَا أَبَا يَزِيد بِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ جِئْتَنِي. O Abu Yazid, with what thing or which thing have you brought towards me and which thing have you come close to me with? Meaning, which path have you taken? Is it mujahada? Is it zuhud? What is it? How did you reach me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. Yes. This is mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards his creation. So Abu Yazid Bastami rahimahullah ta'ala said, bizuhdi fi dunya, with zuhud in the dunya, being ascetic, and what? Of detaching myself away from the dunya while being in the dunya. And this is how I reached you. Kala, innama miqdaru dunya indi jannahu ba'udatin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated, what? That the measure of the dunya, or the rank of the dunya, according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is what? Not even equal to the wing of a mosquito. Meaning it's nothing, and you've been doing zuhud in it. You've been trying to move yourself away from the dunya. And that's why you came to me. For fima zahatta, then what did you do zuhud in? When the world is worthless to me, then what have you been doing zuhud in? And you do zuhud from those things which are precious. You try to stay away from it. Yes, something that's precious to you. Something that you already don't like. And then I'm doing zuhud from it. It's not zuhud, is it? It's not detaching yourself from it. Zuhud is what you love, what you want. You stay away from that. But here what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stating, and he's free of needs, but he says that what is worthless. The dunya is qaleel, is worthless. And you're doing zuhud from that. And you're saying that you came to me and you reached me through that. Bayazid Bustami stated, Ilahi, O my Lord, astaghfiruka min zalika. I do tawbah, I seek your forgiveness from the statement I made, of what, that I did zuhud in the dunya. For the dunya is worthless. Jitu bit tawakkul ilayka. I only came on your trust. I came with tawakkul. I came with your love. I came in trusting you, because the one you love is the one you trust. I came with tawakkul and that's all I have. Faqala inda zalika kabilnaka. Now because you came with tawakkul, this is now when we accept you. Tawakkul. Yeah, this was his way of tawakkul, of muhabba, the close. Bayazid Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala once stated, وَقَفْتُ مَعَ الْعَابِدِينَ فَلَمْ أَرَى لِي مَعَهُمْ قَدَمًا. I stood with the abidin, those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, those people were in that maqam. Obviously, the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They fulfill the obligations and even extra than that. Okay, so it does mean that he's still a worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he's stating that these people were in this maqam, who were constantly in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, I found that I could not stand with them. That my maqam was not with them. Then he says, I stood with the mujahideen. And I found what? That I didn't have a footing with them. Then I stood with those who prayed, those who fasted, and so on and so forth. And I found I didn't have a footing with them as well. I couldn't stand beside them. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَبِّي كَيْفَ الطَّرِيقُ إِلَيْكَ. So I made dua and said, oh my Lord, how is the way towards you? What's the tariqa towards you? فَقَالَ لِي, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to me, اُتْرُكْ نَفْسَكَ وَتَعَالَ. Let go of your nafs and come towards me. Let go of your nafs and come towards me. There's a barik ishara in that. What? In all of the other things, okay, your nafs can be involved in it. Your nafs might love you worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you become mashghul with your nafs. Mujahideen, just to become brave, for people to say you're brave. Riya, summa, and things like this, showing off, comes all into it. Why? Because you're showing people, aren't you? If you're an abid, you're praying salah, then you're praying at night, somebody might see you. Yes? It's an action, isn't it? People see actions. It's not a non-action. It's an action. People see it, so they say, oh, he's ready, he stays up all night, he prays tahajjud. He's tahajjud guzar, like we say in Urdu. Yes? But look, people know about that action. He's fasting. Or he's been fasting for, look, we say this many times, this wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he fasted for so much days. Fasted throughout his whole life. But we're knowing about that. But would you know that you, would anybody know if you left your nafs? If you left your nafs behind, nobody would know. Meaning you leaving your nafs behind, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows of it. Even the angels don't know beside you that you left your nafs behind. Because it's all within. It's all upiya and it's all in your heart. Yes, your nafs is not separate from you. It's you, but you left it behind. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. So what? When you let go of your nafs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he says, ta'al, come. Come into this court. This was his maqam. He once stated that laysa rajulu man yasiru ma'al qafila. A man is not that person who travels with a qafila, a group. Innama rajulu man yanamu ila sibahi fayusbihu amamaha fil manzili. That a man is not that person who travels in a caravan, in a qafila. You know, when you go from one place to another place, you can travel by coach in a group. Yes. And in the old time, they would travel in groups for safety, in caravans. So they would travel like that. So he said, a man is not that person. Look how you understand his maqam from here. A man is not that person who travels with qafilas, with groups. But rather, a man is that person who sleeps. And when he does the morning, the destination is in front of him. Does that go through? A man is not that person who travels with groups from A to B. But what? A man is that person, meaning a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that person who goes to sleep at night, and then when he wakes up in the morning, the destination he wanted to be at was in front of him. That's his maqam. Meaning what? The dunya is kaleel for him. And what? He can wrap it up in his hand. That he can move from A to B in a split second. This was his maqam. He's calling them people men. I wonder what he called us. Alamatul arifi an yakuna ta'amuhu ma wajada wa mabituhu haythu adraka wa shugluhu bi rabbihi. The sign of a arif, the one who recognizes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that his food should be whatever he finds. His resting place is whatever he attains, and his business should be just with his Lord. He should be just busy with his Lord. These are statements which are treasure. You won't find them. They're treasure. What? An arif is that man. The sign of an arif is that he is that person whose food is whatever he finds. He does not complain about his food. If he has an apple, then he suffices upon an apple. And his resting place is whatever he finds. When he goes on Hajj, he doesn't complain about a 5-star hotel or a 1-star hotel. Whatever he finds, rather, Masjid al-Nabawi is sufficient for him. The bare floor is sufficient for him. He does not complain. So whatever he finds, he keeps. And wa shughluhu bi rabbihi. Wherever he is, he's busy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed him in luxury, then he's busy with the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed him in something opposite of luxury, then he's still busy with the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing can move him away from the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once a man came and knocked on his door. When he knocked on his door, he said, that what are you seeking? said to the man, "What are you seeking?" The man didn't reply. Behind the door, Abu Yazid Bustami replied, "Laysa fil bayti ghayrullahi." There's nobody else in the house other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, if you have come to my house to seek anything else of the dunya, you won't find it. There's nothing of the dunya in my house. But if you come for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, you reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this sifat. And this is how we need to be. Another man came to him once. And they came outside his house, a wayfarer passing by. And one of them said, "Ha huna Abu Yazid." This is the place of Abu Yazid Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala. Abu Yazid Bustami screamed. He screamed out loudly, "Inna Aba Yazida fi talabi Abi Yazida munzu awam." Abu Yazid has been searching for Abu Yazid for many, many years. He hasn't found him. What did they say? Abu Yazid is here. Abu Yazid himself screaming that Abu Yazid has been looking for himself for many years and he hasn't found himself. This was his maqam. This was Ibn Arabi rahimahullah ta'ala states that what? He detached himself so much from the world that he even removed himself from himself. They were looking for himself for many years and he hasn't found Abu Yazid yet. He was devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One important saying which we all should take heed of is what? The Amar Allahul Ubad or Ibad. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the creation. He commanded them to do certain things. He prohibited them to do certain things. Amma fa ata'uhu. They all obeyed. Muslims obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What? Whatever he said is haram, is haram. Whatever said is halal, we said it's halal. فَخَلَعَ عَلَيْهِمْ خُلَعًا فَاشْتَغَلُوا عَنْهُ بِالْخُلَعِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a khula upon them, put certain things upon them. Miracles, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their actions, namaz, they pray, salah, fast, hajj, they give zakat. What happened, he states, is that the people became busy with the action and forgot who they're doing it for. Something we need to take heed of sometimes. Sometimes we make ourselves busy with the action itself. And we said this many times that you need to sometimes move away from practicing tajweed in your fard namaz. Practicing tajweed should be done outside of namaz. You know, your mashak should be done outside of namaz. Practice it as much as you like. When you come to your namaz, you should be in a comfortable position that you can pray your namaz, but your concentration should be towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your intention is not to perfect your tajweed in salah. Your intention is not anything else but what? La urida min Allahi illallah. You should not intend anything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that salah. So it's not a field for you to practice in. A difficult statement I'm going to mention next is once a person recited, "Inna batsha rabbika la shadid." Say his para. He stated that indeed, some people might take this the wrong way, indeed the grasp of your Lord, or your Lord to take you in hold of you, not literally, it's a metaphorical meaning the azab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is severe, la shadid, is severe. Meaning when he holds you to account, then it's severe. You know what he stated? Batshi ashaddu. My holding to account is stronger. This is why it's a difficult statement. But we're going to deal with it. We're not going to deal with it. Ibn Arabi is going to deal with it. Ibn Arabi stated that what? A human being, he has many attributes. But many attributes can move away from him. Yes? There can be people who don't even have a single ounce of mercy inside them. And all they have inside them is wrath and anger. And they just punish anybody. Similar like to ISIS. They don't have an ounce of mercy inside them. The Prophet ﷺ said it, they'll be quick on their whips. Something will happen, whip out. And that's what they do. They'll whip people for small things. So you find people like that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such that his attributes are what? that his attributes are without end and his attributes are always remain just as he always remains. Yes? Just as he is Hay, he is Baqi. Okay? His attributes are the same. That they will always remain. And one of the things is that his attributes are always bilfi'l, the actual. Meaning his wrath is upon somebody, his mercy is on somebody. Yes? So when he holds somebody to account, then there is still a matter of mercy inside that as well. There's still a matter of mercy inside that. But when a human holds somebody to account, then mercy totally, because the mercy of a human being can be limited, can't it? The mercy of a human being totally can be removed away from him and he can be severe. Does that make sense? Kind of deep masala, but I want you to mention it anyway, so it's out there. Or what? That he stated that my holding to account can be severe. Why? It's a deep and detailed statement. This what? That my holding to account can be without mercy. My holding to account can be without mercy, but the holding of account of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He holds somebody to account, there's still mercy amongst that. One of those mercies, if somebody is placed in hell, then you look at that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still kept you in existence. That's mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll say it later on. When I mention it here, it's probably further on, we probably will get that far. He stated once that what? That I'm happy for myself. People say that they shouldn't go through hisab. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should not hold them to account. He said, I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hold me to account. Why? Because He will call me forward and say, Ya Ibadi, O my slave. And as soon as He says, O my slave, I will say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now you can do whatever you like. I will say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do whatever you like. If you want to place me in hell, now place me in hell. Because now I am your slave. And it has come from you that I am your slave. All my life I've been leading to be your slave. And on that day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya Ibadi. This was his way of love. This is what love does. Love is not with aql, by the way. Sometimes we determine our love by aql. His was not that way. His way of the soul was not the way of aql. He wanted people to come out of the aql. At one point he stated that the person who thinks that he's a scholar and he thinks that his mind is always present, then he's away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because his was a way of love that he wanted people to let go of all of that and just be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was his way. I mentioned this one point and we'll end upon this. He's got many sayings. Imam Nawawi rahimahullah mentions many, many things about him. That he once prayed behind the Imam in the Jami Masjid. The Imam gave salam. And he said, Ya Aba Yazid. After he gave salam, he said, O Abu Yazid, min ayna ta'kul? Min ayna ta'kulu? Where do you eat from? His way was that he wouldn't leave anything for tomorrow. Qala isbir hatta u'ida salati. Wait 2 minutes, let me repeat my prayer. Look where he repeated his prayer from. Okay. Wait 2 minutes, let me repeat my prayer. Fa innaka shakakta fi rizqil makhluqi. You just doubted the risk of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why I'm repeating my namaz. وَلَا تَجُّوزُ الصَّلَاةُ خَلْفَ مَنْ لَا يَعْرِفُ الرَّازِقِ. Namaz is not permitted, prayer is not permitted, salah is not permitted behind the person who does not recognize the razaq, the razik, the one that gives the food. Who is that? That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do not recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives rizq, then my namaz is not, my prayer, my salah is not done behind you. He repeated his prayer. He repeated his prayer. This is of love, this maqam of love, this is the maqam of tawakkul as well. Tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once he said that, he once just sat and said, Subhanallah. Glory be to Allah. فَنَادَانِ الْخَالِقِ. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called me. Inside him, in his sir, in his secret, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, his creator said to him, that are there any faults in the creator that you are glorifying him? Meaning, Are you glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he has some faults? Meaning things sometimes are prompted, aren't they? If somebody blames you, then what do you say? I didn't do it. Yes? You're taking yourself away from the blame, aren't you? You're freeing yourself from it. So when you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're saying that he is free of all defects and faults. So in his secret, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, that is it that I have some kind of fault in me that you are taking that away? And what did Sayyidina Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala state? قُلْتُ لَا يَا رَبْ Oh my Lord, no, you have no fault. You're the Lord of the universe and you're my Lord. قَالَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, فَنَفْسَكَ نَزِّ أَنِ ارْتِقَى بِرَزَائِلِ Rather than saying subhanallah, what you need to do is perfect yourself. Because why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such that he has no faults. Yes? Glory is for him anyway. He has no faults in him. He is glorified above everything. He has no faults in him. But you are the person who can have a fault in him. You need to perfect yourself and make sure yourself that you are without faults yourself. So what did he do after this game? He started to do and concentrate on his own nafs. He took himself away from all the bad characteristics. He took himself away from all the bad characteristics. And then right at the end of it, what did he say? He said, Subhani ma a'zama shani. After many, many years of cleansing himself, he said, Subhani, glory be to me. What a great shan I have. And this was in Bab of Tahdith and Ni'mat. This is the rank that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. If you want any answers of this, then there's many, many people. Ibn Arabi has answered all of these. Ibn Hajar has also mentioned a few points as well. And many other scholars have mentioned many, many things on these statements. Okay, so they might be troubling statements on the outset, but they're really, hiddenly, they're not troubling statements. So this was the maqam of Sayyidina Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah. There's many, many of his quotes. Many of his quotes. He once stated, لَيْسَ الْعَجُبُ مِنْ حُبِّي لَكَ وَأَنَا عَبْدٌ It's not a wonder, meaning it's not wondrous, what? That I have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I have love for you. Why? Because I am the slave. بَلْ مِنْ حُبِّكَ لِي وَأَنْتَ مَالِكٌ قَدِيرٌ But the wondrous thing is that you have love for me and you are the king and the all-powerful. This is the love, isn't it? And this is the wondrous thing when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his creation, that what? Says to Jibreel that I have love for Abu Yazid al-Bustami. I have love for this wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the famous hadith? And then Sayyidina Jibreel tells the angels of the heavens, and the angels of the skies, and the angels of the skies to the people of the dunya. The angels of the dunya. And then it's amongst the ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this is the man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abu Yazid had that maqam. Take his maqam and how serious he was in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He stated, Lam azal salasina sanatan kullama arattu an azkur Allah aghsilu fami wa lisani ijlala lillahi. He said, for 30 years, every time I wanted to mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I washed my mouth out and I washed my tongue out just to honor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For 30 years. Once a man said to him, that I've heard that you fly in the sky. You know what he answered? And this is his knowledge and his rank. Meaning statements like this only come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you the knowledge. And what is that? He said, Ayyu ajib, what's wondrous about that? فَطَائِرٌ يَاقُلُ الْمَيْتَةَ يَمُرُّ فِي الْهَوَىٰ A bird or something that flies, he eats a maita, a corpse. And as it's eating, it flies in the sky. It flies in the sky. Meaning he eats a maita. It's law of the law. A crow eats a dead corpse. He eats it and then it flies in the sky. Look how low it is. Yes? Look how low it is that it eats a dead corpse or any bird that eats a dead corpse. Something that's not halal according to humans. According to the Sharia of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam for humans. Such low things. He eats it. And then it flies in the sky. Yes? But what? We are human. We are believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-mu'minu ashraf min al-ta'iri. But a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more honorable than that bird who eats a dead corpse. You're more honorable than it. So what's wondrous about this? You should be able to fly. Meaning he's trying to say that this is a norm. If the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fly, then this is a norm. Why? Because birds fly. And what are birds? They're nothing. They eat dead things. They don't care where their food comes from, where it doesn't come from. They just eat. There's many statements here, inshallah ta'ala. If next time we have time, inshallah ta'ala, we'll go through them. The statements were just to give you a sign of how great Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala was. I'll finish on that statement actually, which I mentioned about the mountains. He said, قِيلَ لَهُ هَلْ بَلَقْتَ جَبَلَ قَافٍ, that have you reached the mountain of Qaf? He answered, جَبَلُ قَافٍ لَيْسَ بِغَرِيبٍ, the mountain of Qaf is not rare. It's nothing rare. We see it all the time. بَلِ شَانُ جَبَلُ قَافٍ, it's not the mountain of Qaf, it's the mountain of Kaf. وَجَبَلُ صَادٍ وَجَبَلُ عَيْنٍ, the wondrous and the honor and the rank is for the mountain of Saad and is for the mountain of Ain. These mountains surround the earth. حَوْلَ كُلِّ أَرْضٍ جَبَلٌ بِمَنْزِلَةِ حَيْتِهَا, and around the earth, they surround the earth, and around this earth is a mountain which is equal to its walls. To the mountain, but do we know what he's talking about? This is the rank he had. People like Ibn Arabi understood him. People like Junaid understood him. Many, many other awliya understood him. But this is the knowledge that they got from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His maqam was such that he once in his dream saw a hoor, in his dream. And he stated, at that point, as soon as I looked towards it, in that moment in time, my time was taken away. Meaning his maqam was taken away. Then I looked towards the hoor again, and this time I turned away myself. And at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave everything back. Can happen. There's lessons in this. If we expand them, then we can give many, many lessons towards us that what we need to do, how, what mindset we need to be in. But this was his maqam, these statements. You should look upon them, understand his maqam. Inshallah, if next time we have a chance, we'll go through more of his statements. There's a treasure of his statements, treasure of knowledge that he left for the ummah of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah ta'ala, if this, next time we have time, inshallah ta'ala, we go through them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to understand the maqam of Shaykh Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala. And this was just not even discussing his life. His life is a different chapter altogether of what he did in his life, who were his companions, who were his students. We didn't even touch on that. Okay? If we were to touch on that, that would give a different light to who the actual Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala was. But we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the wasila of Abu Yazid al-Bustami rahimahullah ta'ala, that he put us in his mercy, pardon us, forgive our sins, put us in a position where we are able to walk towards him, run towards him, run towards fulfilling our obligations, have istiqamah upon our obligations, istiqamah upon the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, wa ma alayna illa al-balaghul mubin.